It's November 9th, 2020. This is Roqe. Solidarity between sworn enemies. A well-known Israeli actress, singer, dancer has decided to explore and celebrate her Iranian roots. And now she's got a brand new album about to drop that is in Persian and recorded with musicians from inside Iran. Liraz Charhi is well-known from movies and TV shows in Israel and France and Hollywood. She currently stars in the Apple TV series Tehran. But Liraz has also been focused on identity through music and joins me to discuss new songs that are an homage to Iranian female singers of the past. Plus, the Roqe team reconvenes and Mona Kiani from Inglesi Farsi joins us from Melbourne with a proverb. I'm Jian Ghomeshi. This is Roqe. Hi there, welcome to episode number 60 of Roqe. Omidvar hastam ke shad bashin. Hope you are in good spirits. We are on our ongoing mission to build a new audiovisual encyclopedia of Iranian diaspora identity, coming to you on SoundCloud, Instagram, YouTube, Spotify, iTunes, and Telegram. you can link to any and all of our platforms at the hub of all things Roqe. That's our website, roqemedia.com. It's really all you need, roqemedia.com. Today, I guess in a few moments, we have Liraz coming up. She has a really interesting story, folks. She is a well-known actress, singer, and performer in Israel. She is of Iranian background. And she has a new album coming out this Friday in Farsi called Zen, or Woman. So yes, an Israeli Jewish woman with a new album out in Persian called Zen. She has been on a journey to discover, or rediscover, I suppose, her Persian roots. And this album is the latest stop on that journey. I really think all you folks out there are going to, if you don't already know Liraz, you are going to find her very interesting. You're going to find her story very interesting. And if you don't know her through her music, and she's got this growing fan base, both in Iran and in Israel, of course, she's well known as an actress and a singer, etc. If you don't know her through her music, you may know her because she plays a Mossad agent in Tehran, the series that is now on Apple TV. So the plot thickens. Liraz is involved in all kinds of things to do with Iran and Israel and her identity. And it's very exciting to have her on the show. She's joining us in a few moments. I know that you are a fan of her journey, at the very least, Groovy Shaya, yeah?
Yes. Actually, the first time I got to know her, I saw her with Rita, another great Israeli with Persian root singer.
And Rita is her aunt, is Liraz's aunt. Did you know that?
I knew that they have some relation, but yes. I didn't know. Oh, yes. Aunt. Yes. Wow. Okay, so they're
family. Yeah.
And yeah, I saw Gole Sangam version that they sang together, and I love both of them.
A famous Persian song, yes. You can find that on YouTube.
Yeah, composed by Anushiravan Rohani.
That's right. All full circle. All of the group guests coming together. That's Groovy Shaya. Shaya from Dang Show. Shaya the Great. He has a lot of names. Just Reza Shaya also. Yes. We've just heard news this weekend. I want to mention this as well. Speaking of full circle with Roqe programs, Nasreen Sotoudeh has been released. I mean, we know this because we got a message from her to the general public. Thankfully, it was great to hear that she's been released from prison, at least for now. in Iran. It's always hard to tell exactly what this means, but of course we had our special a couple of weeks ago, the case for Nasreen, with a number of guests. We're going to talk about this more later in the show. You know, she's nowhere near free, but this was good news that she has at least been released temporarily for the sake of her health. We're sending wishes and hopes the way of Iran for Nasreen Sotoudeh, and at the very least for her health to get better. We'll talk more about that later in the show. Hi, fabulous Keon.
Hi, Jian.
How are you?
I'm good.
The fabulous Keon. You know, I guess we got lots of reaction to our Iranians and the American election special.
Yeah, we got a lot of mixed
Everyone angry. Everyone. Why is Keon so right-wing? Why is Jian a Biden apologist? Why did you book those guests? Clearly, the post-Trump healing has begun.
Yeah.
Everybody is feeling
happy.
In a healing space.
Yeah. Listen, people, we're not Gormis Sabzi. We can't make you all happy. So, yeah, we'll get to those.
We'll get to the letters. It's very, you know, I love that the Rook audience proved the point of the show, which was that Iranians are polarized about the American election. If you thought that Iranians were all on one side of this thing, or people of Iranian descent, we certainly know that's not true. And, and none of us appreciate being typecast. I know that you are not simply a Trump lover.
Absolutely,
you know?
Not. Yeah. Someone went as far as to call me annoying.
Well.
They have since deleted the comments.
They did?
Wow.
Yeah.
I was like, well, I've never. Yeah. Not Shia, not Reza.
That's like the nicest
Keon.
Thing I've ever been called. by the way, not unrelated to this election, we had a gathering at my my house, my backyard on the weekend, just a small group of friends. We had bet on who was going to win the election, not necessarily who we wanted to win, but who we thought would win. And I had picked Biden. And as it turns out, most of my friends in this group had picked Trump. So when it was clear that Biden had won, the prize was Persian pizza. Right. Mm. So they come over with Persian pizza. Now, Captain Reza, you know about this, and I think Groovy Shia does, but I think you hadn't had Persian pizza before, had you?
I have.
Oh,
yeah.
You have. I have. Yeah. I hadn't. I mean, I think maybe once I'd heard, but I'd at least forgotten that the point of Persian pizza is. Do you know where I'm going with this?
I totally think I know where you're going.
There's no
it.
Tomato sauce.
That's right.
Right? Yeah. It's pizza with, like, I don't know what this decision was, like, where the decision, what authorities in Tab Shiraz, you know, made the decision. You know, the funny thing is, most Persian stews, as someone who enjoys cooking Persian food, I remind you, Keon, since you always seem to forget that
you're
I cook
quite
Persian
good at
food.
It.
Yes. A lot of our stews are based in tomato, you know. Yes. So, but no, when it comes to the pizza, the Persians have to do something different. We are using no tomato. So what that means is you put ketchup.
Ketchup on it.
So the pizza arrives. There's like four boxes of pizza and everybody's, pizza, Persian pizza. And then there's this bag and I open the bag and a bag that's teeming with like piled with packages of ketchup, right? As if you just ordered a dozen, you know, large fries at Mickey D's at McDonald's, you know? So I'm like, well, what are we? And then there's like a bunch of packages of like some white looking like, as it's like tzatziki.
I don't know why they call it this.
Yeah, sauce marxus, which actually just turns out to be like
Thousand Island
lame salad dressing. You know, that
it's like ranch.
Exactly, yeah. Ranch. So apparently, to our dear non-Persian friends, or to those of us in the diaspora who were so naive about this, you take your pizza and you cover the pizza in ketchup.
Yeah, that's right.
And then maybe some ranch dressing. I mean, what is happening here?
Is it not delicious, though? It's once in a while, not, you know, not as often
you
as
know what? The
pizza.
Pizza was delicious, but it also tasted like pizza with ketchup on it.
Yeah. Still that's delicious. I'm starving.
And to Shia, to you, this is normal, right? Of course you put ketchup on the pizza.
It's normal that we put ketchup on pizza.
So if you go to a pizza parlor in Tehran, is there ketchup on the tables? Like,
oh, yeah. Big.
For the most part, they even pour it on, like, without asking you.
They just put ketchup on the pizza.
Yeah.
I mean, the thing is, it's a weird thing because the pizza was actually quite delicious. delicious without the tomato sauce and without the lame, first of all, generic ketchup, of course, right? It wasn't like good ketchup. It was like the cheapest brand of ketchup, this bag of cheap ketchup. And why destroy the beautiful pizza with the ketchup? But I can feel the audience around the world, the Persians going, how did you not know? Of course, we put in kipizzaya asile. We put the ketchup on the pizza. And, we invented pizza. But to me, it was a very strange experience.
You liked it without the ketchup?
First of all, the ranch dressing, I don't know what that. I don't know what, why,
I don't know that.
I mean, maybe kare or something.
Ew.
I don't know, like a ranch dressing. Anyways, but the pizza, no, I kind of got it. I got why you put it on because it needs a little extra tang. But I would, maybe I put hot sauce on it or something. It's Persian pizza, at least this Persian pizza, it's quite thick. Mm-hmm. It's like deep dish. It's almost like it looks like quiche or something, but like not the vacation spot, Chaya. But and then you put ketchup on it. Anyway, I mean, that obviously is obvious to everyone. Now as well, I remember somebody I'd been dating before, like once we had ordered pizza and like a Persian person and she had said, oh, do you have ketchup? And I was like, well, who is she? She's a weirdo. What's this ketchup thing? Now it turns out I was the weirdo for not putting ketchup on the pizza.
Actually, in Tehran, when we went to a restaurant and the waiter approached us and said, oh, do you want sosa makhsus? And we all said, yes, why not? And they meant arak kishmish by sosa makhsus.
No, wait a second. Makhsus means like special.
In this case, because alcohol is banned in Iran. So that guy was sending... he was speaking with codes. He's like, do you want sosa makhsus? Do you want a little bit of alcohol? Illegal alcohol with your pizza?
When I used to go to Iran, the sosa makhsus was the white sauce. Yeah. And it was the big joke amongst me and my brothers. We're like, what is this special sauce? What are they doing back there? And
the ranch dressing?
It's a white sauce. We're like, what is this sosa makhsus?
Yeah. I'm sure there's some Persian pizzeria that's like, how is he calling it ranch sauce? This is important, sosa makhsus. But it tasted like, I mean, maybe it was just the place we got it from. Tasted like not very good salad dressing.
Yeah.
Right? On top of a really tasty pizza. Mm. Yeah. So, listen, I want to introduce someone who is going to help us out here. We just talked about makhsus, and these words come up, and we grapple with them, we wrestle with them. It's no secret that we are fans of language, and that part of our journey of discovery in the Middle Eastern diaspora and the Iranian diaspora has been one of assessing, addressing, enjoying, employing Persian and English terms and translations. Well, there is a woman named Mona Kiani. Kiani. Yes. Who runs a cool Instagram page called Inglisi Farsi. Now, she's based in Melbourne, Australia. And we've been in touch with Mona, Melbourne Mona, coming on Roqe and helping us out with some of our language, teaching us a little bit. So I think you've got her on the line, right, Shaya?
Yes.
Melbourne Mona, are you there?
Yes, hello.
Hello.
How are you?
Welcome. Hi, and how is everything in Australia?
We're great. We're just coming out of lockdown, so we're feeling good. We're actually fantastic.
Have you ever had Persian pizza, and did you put ketchup on it?
Actually, I've never tried it. It's interesting you say there's no goja farangi on it, and I'm yet to taste this delicacy you speak of.
I'll tell you what, buy a pizza and then put ketchup on it. That's the delicacy.
Excellent.
So first and foremost, it's so great to have you on the program. Tell us why you started this this Instagram channel, this page called Inglisi Farsi.
Well, it's interesting you ask, because this journey started for me when I was 6 months pregnant with my firstborn son. So I was actually never born in Iran. I have Iranian parents, and I was born in Taiwan, but they spoke to me in Persian. And I guess when I was 6 months pregnant, I realized I didn't have the necessary skills to pass on my heritage. So my journey really evolved as a result of motherhood. That's the short story of it. And I developed a set of resources that use a transliteration system, which I like to term Finglisi. which is Farsi and English, which is something that I find useful because my Persian wasn't very proficient. And I grew up speaking Persian, but I was never able to read and write because, you know, as a teenager and as a youth, you kind of rebel against what your family wants you to do. Yep. And I wasn't interested in learning Persian because I wanted to integrate into life in Australia. So fast forward, you know, to motherhood, and I realized that I really wanted to get back to my roots. And the journey has done full circle here where I've created a Persian resources for the Iranian diaspora. Now, just like you're trying to create here.
Right, right. And this Inglisi Farsi Instagram page is actually quite popular. Are you surprised by how popular it became and who is the audience for it?
It's amazing you say that because when I started, I didn't, like, there wasn't a great presence of, like, Iranian Australians or that I could see. And my biggest audience is actually North America. But I am meeting a lot of Iranians in Australia, actually, that are popping up around the place. So it is surprising. I never expected it to grow to this level, but I feel like it's great connecting with everyone all over the world.
Is the audience Iranians or is it non-Iranians trying to learn Farsi, Persian, or who do you think most of the people following you are?
It's a mix. So it's those who are married to Iranians who want to learn the culture, who can't speak themselves. It's those who weren't born in Iran but have the heritage and, you know, can understand conversational Persian. Like myself, second generation Iranians. It's a good mix. And it's also a lot of Iranians in Iran who want to learn English, which is so interesting because they're doing the flip side of, you know, learning the English words when I'm writing the Persian. So it's quite a wide variety.
I have to say, this is a microcosm of my dream for this show, which is for somebody to be teaching us, those of us of Iranian descent in North America, Persian proverbs from Australia, via Australia, someone who was born in Taiwan. This is perfect. So so you're going to help us out with words and proverbs. So I'm told you're going to kick us off this week with a proverb of the week for the Roqe team and for our audience. So how do you do this? What are you going to tell us?
Well, I guess maybe we'll start with the word this week that you might or might not be familiar with. And then if you guess the word, and then we can go into the sentence and move it from there. What do you think about that?
Okay, sure.
Yeah.
Why don't you start with me and Keon, because we probably won't guess the word. We'll try. But yeah.
Oh, I'm sure you're proficient. So the word is gauze. Do you know what gauze means?
Gauze?
Yes.
Gauze? No, not... Gauze, huh? Gas, gauze. Right?
Gas?
No.
Like, no.
And gauze not, is like an animal. It's an animal.
Okay, Captain Reza's laughing. So, Captain Reza, what is a gauze?
So...
Gauze, I mean, actually, my dad used to call a guy down the street who was a bit of an annoying guy and had a long neck. Is it like an ostrich or something?
So what is our national animal in Canada?
Moose.
The beaver.
Moose, no?
Loony.
Oh, the loon.
It's goose.
The goose. Oh,
goose.
A goose. Okay.
That's right.
Goose. All right.
Yeah.
Gauze. Goose. That's, that would seem obvious.
Who knew?
Yeah, well, it's a new word for me, too. So, gauze means goose. So, okay. The proverb of the week is actually morge hamsoye gauze.
Morge
so, can you guess what that means?
That doesn't sound nice, whatever it is.
The chicken of the chicken of the neighbor is a goose.
Is a goose. Making saying they're ridiculous?
No. They're saying that if the chicken is a goose, if the chicken is a goose, it means that it's the grass is always green. It means that you want what the neighbor has. Is that right?
Ding ding ding.
Melbourne,
yes,
Mona.
Correct,
wow. All right. Yes, did you know this? Okay. Say it again. The morge chibud.
Morge hamsaye gaze.
Morge hamsaye gaze.
So apparently, the
chicken of the neighbor is a goose.
I'm gonna call my
Shajun,
mom.
Shajun, you know this saying, obviously.
Yes.
Is it a very simple one? Is it very basic?
Not actually. No, it's good.
Shai, can you use it in a sentence for me?
Yes, Reza's desk is much bigger and better than mine.
Uh-huh.
But it's the same, actually. But مرغ همسایه.
Well, it actually comes from a Latin poet called Ovid, who wrote The Art of Love, but it wasn't the grass is greener. It actually had the meaning of the harvest is always richer in another man's field, which is obviously, you know, the relative terms of back in the day where they didn't really have, you know, flocks of chickens and goose. So they discussed it as a harvest, which is interesting. And I actually had a rook saying for the rook version or the rook adaptation of this saying, which I thought was pretty funny. From a few weeks back, you were discussing some Lubio Polo escapades,
yes.
I believe.
Yes.
So I wanted to say maybe the rook version could be the Kotleta Hamsoye Lubio Poloe.
That was amazing.
So Shaya's Lubia Polo will always be greener because
that's
you didn't
right,
get
that's
any
right.
Jian.
من هر وقت لوبیا پلو میخورم قازم پامپت میشه.
گوزبام.
All right, morgue hamsaye gaze. Our challenge will be to use that throughout the week, right. Keon, in our okay. daily life. You go to the grocery store, you know.
They won't understand parts. They're like, morgue hamsaye.
The ketchup for your pizza costs a little much. You say to the person, morgue hamsaye gaze dige. I'm sorry, what, sir? Nothing. Forget it. It's my new saying. Mona, that's fantastic. We will be in touch again. Melbourne, Mona, the Instagram page is Inglisi Farsi. Inglisi Farsi. We'll, of course, put a link to that on our social platforms. And it's been great to talk to you. Well, get ready for a new proverb for us next week, okay?
Sounds great. Lovely to meet you all in this podcast land.
Thank you, Mona. Bye-bye.
Take care. Bye.
Mona Kiani with the Inglisi Farsi Instagram page and Morgha Hamsay Qaze.
Very useful information. I will absolutely apply that in my life. I'm going to call my mom tonight and tell her that.
All right. We have many angry letters to get to, but on the other hand, Morgha Hamsay Qaze.
Sure,
so
is.
I'm just applying it for no reason to everything. So we'll get to those in a little bit. The fabulous Keon, Captain Reza, Groovy Shaya, Melbourne Mona, thank you again. Let's get to our guest. If I were to tell you some of the most infectious Persian pop music being made this year, replete with Farsi singing and 6/8 grooves, is being made by a Sephardic Jewish Israeli actress and singer who lives and records in Israel, well, take a listen to this. Yes, from her brand new album, Zan, Persian for Woman, that is Liraz Charhi, with a taste of the single Bia Bia. It's ear candy for those who love Persian melodies and great voices. And the person at the center of it has quite a story. Liraz is a popular actress, singer, and dancer who takes inspiration from the music of pre-revolutionary Iran, in particular the likes of female greats like Ramesh and Gugush. Liraz was born in Ramleh, Israel, to a Jewish family of Iranian descent. She began singing and performing at the age of 5, made her musical debut in 2004, and also began a film career around the same time with the movie Turn Left at the End of the World. She gained attention with a nomination by the Israeli Film Academy for that film. She was invited to the Israel Film Festival in Los Angeles in 2006, and after that, she broke into Hollywood. Liraz Charhi has since become known for her roles in the French TV miniseries Revivre and the films Fair Game and A Late Quartet, in which she played the jogger and flamenco dancing girlfriend of Philip Seymour Hoffman. More recently, you may have seen Liraz in the brand new popular espionage TV series Tehran, where she stars as Ya'el Kodosh, an Israeli Mossad agent. As a musical artist, Liraz has gained a following in Israel and has a growing fan base in Iran. Owing to mutual animosities, of course, between Iran and Israel, Liraz can neither visit Iran nor can the Iranian musicians who work with her travel to Israel. Cut off from the home of both her parents as well as her self-proclaimed spiritual and artistic home, Liraz has made it her mission to bring cultures, sounds, and peoples together. Her new album, Zen, comes out at the end of this week on Friday. But first, right now, Liraz Charhi joins me from Tel Aviv, Israel. Hello.
Hello, how are you?
What a pleasure it is to have you on the program. Thank you for doing this.
My pleasure. Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm very excited to be hosted by you.
You know, I know there are so many periods as an artist where you're just working on your creativity or you're shooting scenes or you're recording a record. Right now, Liraz, you have an album coming out later this week, a hit series playing around the world with Tehran, a lot of international media attention. It must feel like it's all suddenly coming together for you, huh?
It's all coming together. It's the same lady in different roles, speaking about her very, very complex emotions about Israel and Iran. Yes.
So, listen, there are no doubt many people who know who you are, especially in the Middle East, or those who've seen you in films and TV. By the way, A Late Quartet has always been one of my favorite films. It's a remarkable film.
Thank you.
But we are also probably introducing you to a whole new swath of folks around the world. A few days ago on Instagram, you wrote, "Secret is my name. My parents gave me that name, Liraz, my secret, because Raz means a secret, both in Farsi and Hebrew. Always wondered why? Now I have the answer." That sounds somewhat cryptic. What can you tell us about that post?
I can say that I always felt that I'm wondering, how is it to be Iranian in Iran? I grew up to both parents who left Iran and moved to Israel when they were teenagers. It was before the revolution. And I actually grew up like I had two personalities. One of them is Iranian and the second is Israeli. And each time I had to go from my own home to school, I felt I'm switching countries. And I've been always asking myself, who the hell am I? And I tried to find my identity in every piece of Iran that I actually didn't have, because unfortunately we cannot visit Iran. And I started to feel that I'm having this hole in my heart that I'm trying to fill, but I don't have a clue how to do it. I heard so many beautiful stories about Iran, about the culture, the weather, the food, the people. And each time I opened the television, I watched a very, very difficult and different and complex Tehran with extreme Islam and regime, and people are trying to fight over their freedom. Especially, I took very, very, I was very curious about the muted ladies, the muted women in Iran that are not allowed to sing for the last 42 years since the revolution.
Yes.
And I started to dig in this Iranian culture in Los Angeles. That was the point I decided to sing in Farsi.
Let me get to that. First of all, let me say this notion of dual identity or confused identity infects many of us around the diaspora. That's part of the point of this show, is that we have this connective tissue because we're all a little confused about, you know, we have this umbilical cord to Iran, but we are also identify with the country, like in my case, Canada, or your case, Israel, that we've grown up in. How aware of being Iranian were you when you were growing up as a Jewish kid in Israel?
I was very aware. Most of the time, until I was like teenagers, I was very shy about it. I did not want my parents to speak to me in Farsi in front of my neighbors or my friends. I did not want it to be different. I struggled to be Israeli because this is what I saw at home, both very young parents who's struggling to be Israeli in a country that is very young. So I was very confused. But when I grew up, I understood that I really want to be in the arts, and I needed to go back and to explore my roots and my heritage, because I wanna go forward and I wanna grow.
Was it a very traditional family?
Yes. From outside, you could watch like a very liberal family. We're not religious, but something, you know, without even speaking about it, the DNA, my blood is Iranian. Being a good girl with good manners, obeying in a good way, like having this feminine behavior, coquettish manners of Iranian little girl and growing up. I understood from time to time that it's a force. It's even super force, and sometimes I could be, you know, I could laugh about it. Sometimes I get mad about it, and I started to understand that I need to break my own walls to get what I want in my own home. For example, I wanted to sing, I wanted to dance, I wanted to play the piano. It took me a while to make my parents understand, especially to my dad, that this is what I'm doing. It's not a hobby. I'm in the arts.
Right.
And it was very clear to me that I need to start my own private revolution just to become the person that I want to be, the woman that I want to be in this world. And I have lots of great women characters in my family, and I've watched and explored each one of them breaking her own wall at her own time.
I should say one of them is your Aunt Rita, who is a well-known singer and actress also in Israel. I know you two are close. Did having her as some kind of role model affect your choices in life?
Definitely. Definitely. First of all, she's the most lovable, successful singer in Israel. She's the best. And I remember when I watched her growing and developing her personality and her career, I understood that my dream can be accomplished because it's possible. Even inside this family and breaking these walls, she could do it, and I can do it. I mean, she gave me a lot of inspiration and hope, definitely.
Let's hear a little bit of you and Rita performing live. You know, you said before I leave this notion of dual identity, or actually I probably won't leave it because it'll pervade this whole interview because it's who you are. But you said something interesting in an interview where you said you had two characters when you were growing up, this being the Iranian and Israeli.
Yes.
And I actually thought, I mean, on the face of it, I get that. That's part of the whole dual identity kind of nature. But I thought it was an interesting way to put it, two characters. It almost sounds like you could be or you were two different people. Would you see yourself that way? Like there's the little Iranian Liraz and then there's the little Israeli Liraz?
Definitely. I agreed with myself in a very young age that I'm a very layered character, and I have complex issues in my life. From one hand, I'm determined, and from the other one, I'm very fragile, and I have to improve myself in a very masculine world. I understood that I have to take advantage of it, because most of the time until I was a teenager, I was apologizing about this, you know, like, oh yes, my background is Iranian, but I'm Israeli. I tried to neglect, you know, my heritage and to leave it behind me. But as I mentioned, the hole in my heart just got bigger and bigger, and it was a very bad feeling, being and acting like foreign in the country that I was born. I mean, it was too crazy for me to grow up like that.
Did the other kids ever take issue with you being Iranian? Were you ever discriminated against, or did you have problems, like you get into fights, or?
Of course, I had a time that there was a team that find out that this is my fragile issue, and they laughed about the fact that I'm Iranian and that my eyebrows are too thick and that I look darker than them. And I was strange. My look was strange. I didn't know that it's special. I thought that I'm not okay, that I'm not special. I have to tell you that the minute I understood that I don't have to apologize my background and my very layered personality, the minute that I stopped apologizing and I stopped choosing sides. I'm not Iranian and I'm not Israeli. I'm Iranian and I'm Israeli.
Yes.
I'm both. The minute I excused myself, I can say, my heart opened and this hole got little and I fulfilled it with my heritage and my personality. And it's the first time I understood that a human being and nevertheless, an artist has to be in his truth always to create and to develop. I mean, the minute I released myself from this feeling of being foreign or to choose any side, I understood that everything that I want will happen to me, and it did.
I love that. I love that you found that place of release, and I love that you're now actualizing it too in the work that you do. It makes the story so gratifying. I want to get to that. Before I do, so you're this kid growing up who loves the arts. You want to get into theater. You love music. You end up enlisting in the Israeli army. I'm guessing because you have to when you're in Israel. You're in the Israeli
yes.
Defense Forces.
Yes.
Serving as a soldier in the Education Corps military band. Was it ever strange? I don't know anything about being in the army. Was it ever strange to be in the army for Israel, knowing your lineage and that Iran is the stated enemy country? Did that ever enter into it for you?
I had this big dream to be in the like a spy in the army and to go to Tehran. I had this like crazy crazy dream, but I understood that I'm not going to this kind of serving because I really wanted to sing. But for your question, definitely I've never understood that Iran is our enemies. I cannot say that we're enemies country. I don't believe in that saying because I don't know politics. I don't care about politics. All I care about is my heritage, and the fact that I cannot visit Iran gave me the strength to explore her more and to know more about it. And, my relation today with my Iranian fellows and with Iran is bigger than any politics or any circumstances.
The amazing part of that is your discovery, as you alluded to a few minutes ago in this interview, your awakening around being Iranian partly happened in LA, of all places. You went to the States, and so you become this well-known actress in Israel. But you say you really discovered your Iranian roots when you moved to LA in 2006. I mean, it sounds oxymoronic. How did you discover yes. Iran in America? Tell us.
First of all, I had a lot of fun to do back and forth, Tel Aviv and Los Angeles. I found out that I have lots of family that I didn't knew before. So I felt like Iranian in an Iranian neighborhood in Los Angeles. And second, going from audition to audition, it's pretty much boring. You can go inside a room with 100 beautiful actors, maybe much more talented than me, and you just have to wait in line and do your hair and makeup and go on high heels. It's not me. It's really not me. And then I found out that Los Angeles is actually Tehrangeles. I found out that there are a million Iranian people in Los Angeles, not as an expression, really a million people, Iranian people in this Tehrangeles. So I was like, what is going on? I started to walk in the Iranian neighborhoods, and people approached to me and speak to me in Farsi. It was, they were sure I'm you know, from their neighborhood. And I said, oh my God, never happened to me that someone approached and speak to me in Farsi, ever. So I started to call my agents and tell them, okay, I'm not going today to the auditions because I found out this beautiful neighborhood, and like, and they like, okay, Liraz, okay, we understand. And the best part in these beautiful neighborhoods, the part of, you know, the good foods, finally I eat the non-kosher Iranian food with every magic they can do inside their food, like with rice with butter and like lots of
Wait a second. So in Israel, there's obviously, there's got to be Persian food, but it's kosher?
It's kosher.
So you can't get non-kosher Persian food in Israel?
Mm-mm, no.
Oh.
No. I didn't even knew how it tastes, you know? I never imagined that it can be so tasty. I mean, the Iranian food is the best, not because I'm Iranian. It is the best, but suddenly you eat it with butter and with like, oh my God, I gained a couple of
right. You hung out at the Kababis.
Yeah, definitely.
So, but this is, I mean, you make a joke of it, but it's quite a decision because you decide to then that you want to make music, you want to sing in Farsi, a decision that undoubtedly confounds your agents who are busy building you this successful acting career.
Yeah.
How difficult a decision was that?
It was a process, you know. In this neighborhood, I founded lots of beautiful music shops, and I got so many overweight suitcases with vinyls and CDs of the music of the 70s, Iranian 70s. And I remember that the street corner that I was standing on, and I understood that I need to sing, and I actually felt like a baby is falling inside my arms and asking me to sing her in Farsi. I was pretty much shocked, and I said to myself, no way this is happening to me. It's like the feeling that you're falling in love with the wrong person. I said, no, not him, no. Everyone else, but not him. I said, I sing in every language, but not in Farsi. No, it's not happening to me. But it did. And I understood that it's not about me. It's about this baby that chose me, that I will be the pipe and I will be the one to tell and to sing about my heritage and the Iranian stories of my family. I understood that it's like a mission that I've got. And after I collected lots of Iranian 70s music, I understood that I chose the pre-revolution songs of beautiful singers, idols, women, which I recognized a very thick layer of sassiness and courage on their voices.
Yes, you weren't just inspired by Iranian music, but in particular the voices of female singers from Iran, especially in that pre-revolutionary period.
Yes.
They inspired you, they moved you. What can you put into words what it is about the voices of female singers of that era of Iran that so inspired you?
Yes, of course, I understood everything afterwards. It was a process. When I asked myself, why did I choose these ladies? First of all, these ladies did not stop singing after the revolution. They just moved to other countries to continue their beautiful career, like Gugush, Haide, Mahasti. They had a beautiful careers, and they did not stop singing. So I found it very powerful. They were like Wonder Woman to me, you know? And second, I love the music because I understood that most of the people who wrote the music in the 70s left Iran to study music in Europe, and they got back to Iran and they brought to the music a mix of layers of European and Iranian sounds. So I felt that I'm connected to this music because it's pretty much my story of my layers. I mean, you could hear the music layers and fall in love with this because, you know, the playlist of my family was pretty much going repetitively, you know, in weddings and parties. It was the same songs and I had enough about it. I mean, it was okay. How many times you can dance to Oy Anar Anar Biobe Bolina? I mean, okay. And said, okay, it's nice, it's beautiful, but I wanted more. And finally, I found this beautiful layered music and productions and instruments. So this really catched me, it catched my heart. And I understood that I'm going to release the first album with this music, but with my layers. I wanted to find a producer to put electronic beats to make it like electro 70s pop. It took me many years to find out the person, and of course to stop my ongoing career here in Israel and to tell everybody that I'm going to sing in Farsi. Most of them told me, oh, you're doing a big mistake because it's the niche and you have a mainstream career that's yes. going very well.
Yes.
And the minute I've heard the word niche, I said, yes, I want to be in this niche. I want to do a niche music.
That's amazing.
And this is what I want to do.
You've never been worried when somebody, an agent or a professional in the business or something says, you got to ruin your career, kid. What are you doing? You know, don't run in this path. We could make you a big star. That doesn't intimidate you. That doesn't scare you. That doesn't worry you.
Of course. First of all, I had it all here in Israel. And I had a very good start in Hollywood, but I cannot even explain how determined I was. I worked very hard for like 5-6 years because I knew that I'm going to stop doing what I'm doing just to sing in Farsi and to tell my story. So, and that I have enough money to, you know, to record and to travel the world and to meet great musicians and, you know, to be inside this, like to build my own new bubble. And I needed to change my team. The one that believed in me stayed with me, and the one that did not, I had to make this breakout, you know. But it was all for good, thank God. And the minute I gave birth to my oldest daughter, I have two daughters, I understood, okay, that's enough. I cannot imagine that I'm going back to my old life. I need to sing. I need to produce this album ASAP. And the minute I've decided, everything happened. I found my team and my producer and a great team who actually understood how to tell my story outside. I was sure that I will open, you know, a concert and very, very small amount of people will come. I wasn't sure that they will take this Iranian side very good. But I was very surprised to understand that they love the music, despite the fact that they don't understand a word in Farsi.
Well, all of this is actually a great setup for talking about your new album, because mm-hmm. it's not just that the album, I think, sounds great. It's that the making of it is quite a remarkable story. The lengths you go to in order to make it and to do it with Iranian musicians inside Iran. You've said making this album, you said, I want to quote you, technically it was very difficult, but emotionally it was much more difficult. I felt night after night that I was doing a bad thing, that these people could be arrested.
Yes.
what exactly did you worry might happen, and why was it so important for you nonetheless to go ahead with this?
The minute I released the first Iranian album, Naz, I got so many great friends from Iran, followers, that was, you know, very excited about the fact that Israeli singer, a woman, can sing freely in Farsi in Israel. And I'm posting like videos from shows in Tel Aviv that people are dancing to Iranian songs, and they were saying, "Was this creature? Who are you? We want to know more. Continue singing. You are singing our freedom, because we women here are not allowed to sing." And I felt it's like my therapy to sing for them. I understood that I'm growing my next dream, which is to write an album with Iranian artists from Iran. And I started to post on Instagram that I'm looking to work with musicians and with specific players with specific instruments. And I got so many great opportunities to meet beautiful people, really. And I built my team, and I have a very, very, he's like my brother from another mother, Iranian musician. I understood that it might be a problem, because I felt this danger that sometimes they're hesitating to be in touch with me, and they're we have the time for recording and they disappear. And I felt like I'm starting to be in this roller coaster. It was in and out and in and out, and they disappeared and they got back, and they wanted to bring me song, and then they wanted to take the song back, and they wanted me to take the song, but they did not want to be in the credits. So many emotional things.
But Liraz, you clearly, I mean, you've lived in, or you've spent a lot of time in LA. I mean, you mm-hmm. could have worked with Iranian musicians who live in the diaspora, or even, you know, as we've heard that there's Armenian musicians who play Iranian music. You know, you could have found all kinds of ways to, why was it so important that they be in Iran?
Because
obviously it was important for them too. They wanted to do this. You know, I mean, you ended up making this record, and I'm curious what the conversations were.
Because every time we ask ourselves, why the hell are we doing what we're doing if we're afraid? The answer was the same. And believe me, we asked these questions twice a day. Like, oh my God, are we doing the right thing? Why am I choosing to dream this dream? I could have recorded this album everywhere in the world. Why am I doing it like this? The answer was because we love each other, you know? Iran loves Israel, and Israel loves Iran. And there are lots of people from Iran and Israel that are in touch. Mm. And we have this bridge to be in touch and in love with our arts. I mean, it's a big, big, you know, message, and a big, big therapy to each side, you know. They were curious about me, and I was curious about them. And after one session of like a baglama player who's playing on one of my songs, that I was like mesmerized and shocked about how beautiful he plays, I said, okay, I cannot be there, but it can happen. It's different. I worked with beautiful, amazing players from Istanbul. And in Israel, we have great musicians, but they do not have the same layers that I have, the emotional layers. They are complex as myself. Their characters are very layers, and they have this passion to know me, and in the opposite. So suddenly to bring this in the arts, it's crazy. It's like we were on high, you know. We were so happy to do it, despite the fact that we were very afraid, but we felt we're doing the right thing. And of course we wanted to keep the sound of the tracks very underground, the same way that we recorded them.
And in the time that you've been making music, that your first album Nas and this this one Zan, have you encountered any trouble? Have you ever had authorities in Iran, you know, approach some of the people you're working with, or create any issues?
You are not going to believe to my answer. I had two very bad messages on my Instagram page. That's it.
Well, I'm very happy to hear that. And I'm also happy to hear that when you talk about, you know, wanting to create that connection between the, and or expose that love between Iranians and Israelis. I mean, even if it doesn't happen at the political level with the leaders, etc. You know, I was wondering, I mean, you've kind of been thrown into this place, whether you like it or not, and it's of your own doing in terms of wanting to pursue this career, but of being a kind of ambassador, you know. I was doing the research on you, and you posted a version of Aga Yeruz, the famous Farmaz Aslani song, back in 2014. And I was going through the comments, and I read comments like, love, love, love. This is the true history of Israelis and Persians. This is somebody writing from like Iran or something, you know. And I thought, this is amazing. Like, people are seeing you as some kind of avatar to bring these cultures, these peoples together. Is that part of your intent, to address the history or the interaction of Israelis and Persians?
I think that back in my heart, maybe, but I didn't really thought when I started to sing in Farsi. It was actually, as I mentioned, it was like a mission. I just wanted to sing my pain out. And when I decided to record Zan, I started to write about the muted ladies, about the fact that we can actually raise our voices, raise our heads, and sing for our freedom, to rejoice, to dance, to laugh. I mean, this is the only thing we can do. The only thing I could do is to sing. I mean, this is what I know. And I did not know that I will get so much love and support. You know, I always said, where is the hole? If there is a hole somewhere, and you are talking about it, people will try to fulfill it, you know, to make it one big thing. So I really felt that without saying anything, just releasing the first song, Aga Yeruz, it was the first experience of me going inside the studio with an amazing oud player. And I released it and I said, okay, this is my first thing that I can do, just to release it. I cannot imagine that Farmaz Aslani will write me a personal message on Facebook after a couple of months.
Aga yeruz beri safar beri ze pisham bi khabar asir royah misham dobare baz tanha misham be shab migam pisham bemune به بعد میگم تا صبح بخونه از دیار یاری چرا میری تنها میذاری.
Everything is a surprise. Even now when I'm talking to you, when I'm listening to you, I'm literally with tears in my eyes, because this is so important for me to tell a story that we cannot forget where we came from. I mean, we're always looking for the truth, but the truth is inside us, inside our hearts, inside our layers. We're always trying to be something else, to get new in something, but sometimes we have to feel like we're old souls to get to know us better. You know, I was always I thought that one day I will find my superhero, my Wonder Woman, and I will understand something from her. But of course, I have my two grandmothers and my mother and lots of great women in my family. But I found out that each one of us is this Wonder Woman, you know? We don't have to look around. It's inside ourselves. And when I think about it, it makes me feel full of hope for my daughters as well, for their future, for more positive future, just to keep doing what I'm doing and to sing my heritage and to send my love to Iran that I'm longing so much and I don't even know.
You know, the emotions you're feeling, I'm sure you have no idea how much I relate to those emotions. It's actually the reason why I started this program, and that journey of discovery of our background, especially in the context of all that's happened over the last half a century to do with Iran and Iranians, and the confusion that is sown from that. It is so important, and I completely understand. I can't put myself in the position of wanting to be Wonder Woman, because I'm not capable the way you are, but for all the rest of what you said, it means so much. You have also been developing this following in Iran. You know, you have fans there who I'm guessing you hear from on social media. Tell me what that means to you.
Getting so much love and attention from Iranian people is a thing that I'm still getting used to. It like I'm getting excited from every comment. I mean, sometimes I can find myself wake up until 4 or 5 in the morning writing to each one of them a message back. I live inside Google Translate because I cannot read Farsi, so I'm copy pasting every comment, or I'm you know, taking a pic to my and sending it to my mom, and she translated to me. It's very important for me to read every comment and to get to know them better, because one day I will meet them. I can say secretly here that I met some of them during my tours in Europe. They made me surprise and met and brought themselves and their friends to my concerts. There is a great story when I was in Roskilde festival in Denmark, and that was a great show. Normally in Israel I speak about my heritage during the show, but in tours I'm speaking like 2 minutes and that's enough. Most of my show is like a big Iranian crazy party when people are starting to dance like crazy, which is so good to see them like that. It's wow, it's very powerful. So I think it was the encore when I saw someone with a big flag is approaching the front row and is coming toward me, and I said, okay Liraz, this is the moment that some of the people will protest and will put a Palestine flag in your face. What am I doing? Should I continue singing? Should I smile? What should I do? I was asking myself so many questions, and suddenly I see this guy is bringing up a big flag of Iran and waving and smiling and rejoicing, and I said, what is going on here? I felt like I want to leave everything and I want to, you know, I want to smash him from love. And of course I've met him afterwards at the backstage, and wow, this was a big moment for me, understanding that it's so worth it to leave an ongoing career and to leave the mainstream and to stop shooting films for a couple of years and TV series and theater, and to having babies and pumping for milk when I'm on tours and on airplanes, and you know, so many sacrificing. My husband that needed to work so many years so hard that I could, you know, do what I'm doing. It's all worth it because it's all about love, and we don't need anything. You know, countries can be enemies, but we don't care about it. We love each other.
Liraz, on the cover of Zen, of this new album record, you're wearing a rusari. You have the headscarf. Tell me about that.
Yes.
Tell me why.
When I started the connection with the Iranian ladies, I've noticed that they're very, very high class fashion. I got so many underground videos of them dancing to my music in underground parties, taking off their rusari and wearing Versace and Dolce & Gabbana, and they're very like neat and stylish.
Yes.
So I've watched them, you know, the way that they are dressing and the way that they are behaving with the rusari. I fell in love with it. I felt it like, from one hand, I wanted to say, just take it off because you have a beautiful hair and face. And from the other hand, I said, okay, but scarves can be so beautiful. It's like a fashion. And I remember that on one of my tours, I've been asking my designer that I've been working with to design me a rusari from the same fabric that I wear his designs, like I was wearing an overall. And I remember that I put it on my head when I started to sing the first song, when I got on stage. And I felt that suddenly at the second song, I'm peeling off this scarf and I started to dance with the scarf.
Yeah.
And I'm following this extremely mesmerizing ladies who are singing in trains, taking off their scarf and protesting for their freedom. So I could identify with them and tell their stories on my shows. And suddenly I felt that because I identify with them and I recognize with them, I want to be with this scarf in my shooting, in my music videos, and on stage. I feel when I'm wearing it that I'm a part of them, you know?
You know, I am so enjoying speaking to you, and I'm so grateful for the time that you're giving us. I must, before I let you go, ask you about this role of yours in the hit Apple TV series Tehran. I've got to say, it's quite an addictive series. I binge watched it the first season. I think there's going to be a second season. I understand you partly got this role because of your Persian background. But again, I mean, just like the story of your life and the story, there's all kinds of interesting contradictions. I mean, you play a Mossad agent, and you also speak Farsi in it at times. What did you have to learn to pull this role off? And tell me about the decision to be part of Tehran.
First of all, I really love your questions for sure. I'm enjoying this interview very much, so thank you for that. You know, the part of Tehran was like a part of my heart. It was very clear to me that Yael Kadosh, this Mossad agent, Tamar's supervisor and commander, is very, very similar to me. She's also has a complex feeling about Iran and Israel. She needs to choose which side is she, and she got to Israel from Tehran when she was teenagers. It's like the background of my parents. She's longing to Iran. She's growing up and she's trying to improve herself in a very masculine world. And she's uprooted like me. Lots of points and baselines in her characters that's very similar to my life. So I felt that it's very, very natural for me to play El Kadosh. And I had this biggest dream to be a spy, as I mentioned at the first, at our first conversation. So
I felt that emotionally I can really rule my role, you know? And I really loved the way it was written and this intimate stories behind the scenes of the big issues of these two complex countries,
yes,
of Iran and Israel.
You can't travel to Iran, obviously, but this series does quite a remarkable job of it's shot in Athens, from what I understand. Mm-hmm. And I have friends who go to Iran or go to Tehran quite regularly who've said that parts of this series look amazingly like it's in Tehran, you know, that it was shot
Definitely.
There. What was it like shooting in an ersatz kind of Iran surrounded by, I think there was a fair number of Iranian actors on this too. So you almost like you're in a de facto kind of Iran, but in Athens. What was that like for you?
It was crazy. And suddenly I could actually hug the Iranian actors and work with them. And of course, most of them were, you know, afraid too, because they took this understanding and decision to work in an Israeli production, which means that they cannot visit Iran anymore. It's a big, big decision for them. So we felt like a big family. The funny thing is that we thought the Farsi language will be, like, you know, very easy for all of us. But apparently, you know, we understand we all speak a different dialect, and we needed to work on one dialect in this TV series. So we actually broke our teeth, and it was so hard for all of us to work on the Farsi and the Farsi language. It was crazy. We didn't have a clue that we were going to deal with this Farsi dialect, and of course we didn't really understood that our emotions are going to be so crazy about meeting each other and participating with each other.
Has your mom watched it?
Of course.
What does she say about your Farsi?
She says that she's very surprised. She was very surprised, you know, because of the role and because of my Farsi. And, you know, we don't speak Farsi at home with this language of Mossad agents about
right.
bombs and electric things, and, you know, it's a whole different language. So she was very surprised. She said, oh, I don't know this word. I don't know this sentence. I did not understand. I said, oh, so I know more than you. That's funny.
Liraz, how do you deal with being in a series that for some people is controversial or comes under some criticism? I mean, it's been hugely successful, but, you know, and on the one hand, Tehran is admirable and bold in that it's an Israeli production that offers viewers actually somewhat sympathetic view of Iran and Iranians. On the other hand, some people say it comes off suggesting that Iran is a place full of bad guys and that the Israeli position is ultimately the just one. There's a review in Variety magazine that said, and I want to quote it, says, Tehran doesn't exclude Iranians entirely, but does frame them as allies or obstacles of a Mossad mission depicted uncritically and somewhat blankly as the work of justice. Do you worry about these kind of criticisms, or that you're somehow involved in something that undermines the way Iranians are seen?
From the comments that I got when my Iranian followers understood that I'm going to play a Mossad agent, they told me, oh, we thought you love us, Iranian people. You're going to participate in a Mossad role.
Right.
I don't think it's nice, but the minute they watched the whole show, they understood that the story is not about the complex issues of Iran and Israel. The story is about us, very simple people behind the scenes, that we're all human, that we're all having problems, and we're all uprooted, and we do not have to choose side. We're just normal people. And the minute that they watched the show, you know, this criticism was off. It wasn't the issue. you know, when you read critics on Variety and on other newspapers, it's okay, but you know, at the end of the day, it's a show, it's art. I mean, anyone can say anything about it. It's okay.
Are you surprised, or did you have a sense that this would be as successful as it is? It's become this hit show, from what I understand, around the world now.
Yes, definitely. I'm not surprised, because I really felt that we are working on a very special thing. I know that the writers and producers have been working on this TV series for 6 years, and I heard so many good things about the people who created this show, and we all felt that we're doing something good, special. As much as I did my album, I felt that I'm doing something good with the message, and even if it's for my own daughters, you know, I do something that is telling the stories from another angle, not the things that we watch on television, you know, like extreme regime and people are having tough life. I mean, there are normal like me and you, you know. So I think we understood very quick that we're doing something very special.
My parents gave me that name, Liraz, my secret. I always wondered why. Now I have the answer. I love how I'm so inspired by the positive place you've gotten to and the work that you do. And I thank you so much for the time. I want to go
thank
out on
so
on this song called Inja. Inja, yes. From your new album that comes out later this week. What can you tell us about Inja?
Inja is a song about like world crisis and emotional private crisis of a couple who's trying to struggle to this crazy reality. I actually wrote it before the COVID came, and it's very actual for now. And the meaning of this song, the bottom line, is to remember that we're living here and now. Trying to forget about our future and about our past, being polite and excuse each other in any crisis we have, and stick to each other with a lot of freedom of being who we really want and need to be here and now. Inja.
I hope your husband, your kids, your workload, your life will allow you to tour in a post-COVID period and come to North America and around the world with your music. We'd love to see you perform live here too.
I wish it will happen so fast, because so many shows got canceled because of this COVID, but I'm sure we will see each other very soon. And I hope that everyone that hears this beautiful interview will come to one of my show and dance with lots of Nas and Das.
Thank you so much for this today, Liraz. Take care of yourself. Be safe.
Merci.
Khodafez.
Merci. Khodafez.
Singer, actress, dancer Liraz, her new album Zen comes out Friday. Liraz joined us from Tel Aviv, Israel today. I love that. A version of the Roqe theme done by Toronto-based santur player Sina Bataille. He's great what he does. He kind of does new style santur in a fusion sort of way. His last album was called Ray of Hope, came out in 2017. Check him out. Hopefully you can actually see him live when, you know, COVID ends in the next few decades. Sina Bataille and his santur version of the Roqe theme there. The Roqe team has gathered back around, Captain Reza Gurbishaya and the fabulous Keon. Wow, Liraz, she I love how open she was in that interview. That was a lot of fun to do. Yeah. She is very clearly on this journey about discovering her identity. It was weird to me that she was saying Iran, which is, I've had a campaign for about 30 years of my life to tell people like it's Iran, not Iran. And, you know, the only people who say Iran are like, you know, anti-Iranian certain Republicans in the States or whatever, you know, former George Bush sycophants. But here was a... I mean, even Netanyahu says Iran, so I'm not sure why Liraz, but it was very charming otherwise, her accent, her way of speaking. Your impressions, the fabulous Keon?
I'm always so fascinated by anybody that has that duality of being Israeli and Iranian, because the media basically is promoting us to be against each other, but that's simply not the case. And you see someone that's Israeli-Iranian who embraces her Iranianness when she's kind of taught not to embrace that. So it's nice to see her rediscovering her roots and embracing it. And I love the fact that she sings songs in Iranian. That's really beautiful.
And the passion and excitement for what she's doing. You know, my experience has been, of course, in the diaspora. I don't know what it's like inside Iran, but most Israelis that I've ever met not only have... it's not just that they have an affection for Iranians in a lot of cases. They really seem to understand Iranians in a way that people say in North America don't, you know? And that was true. I mean, that's obviously true of Liraz because she is Iranian. But those stereotypes, the non-insider person who would just like, a non-Iranian, non-Israeli, who would just like look from the outside, I guess would assume that, you know, we're running around as sworn enemies. But that there's actually such warmth, you know.
We have so much in common, cuisine, language even. So how can we hate them?
What's the cuisine we have in common?
Like the hummus. The flavors, few times that I've had Israeli, the spices we use are very similar, and they love Iranian food. So.
That's right. And I love some of the food that comes out of Israel. So, Captain Reza, did you have anything to say about Liraz?
When you say Iranian diaspora and Iranian community is outside of Iran, is always North America, Australia, and Europe. You never think of the fact that there is a huge population of Iranian community in Israel, and that's part of the diaspora as well. And it kind of had
Iraq or Syria or India.
Kuwait.
Who will speak for Kuwait?
I will.
We have a little Iowan girl, Des Moines girl.
Say for a fact there's a lot of Iranian Kuwaitis in Kuwait. Mm-hmm.
So you were fascinated that there was an Iranian in Israel.
I had a bit of an epiphany. Like, I started to cry. No, I'm joking. But it was interesting. And she, what I found funny was that her mom told her after watching Tehran that, I don't understand some of this Farsi stuff that you're speaking now. So your Farsi must be better than mine.
Her Farsi, having binge watched, as I said, Tehran, her Farsi is an interesting, I mean, I'm not one to talk in terms of my own lahja, but it's an interesting version of Farsi that she speaks on the series, right, Chaya?
Yes, actually, I also sometimes I didn't understand what she says on this series. I read subtitle and it says in Farsi, but I was like, okay.
But if you watch it on Apple TV, you can see the English translation of Well, I'm so grateful that you came on the show. I'm so interested to get to hear reaction from folks and to see how her album does. And I love the idea that she gets these notes from young Iranians in Iran of love, you know, of loving what she's doing. A big thanks to Liraz for coming on. Okay.
Question. Navid Negahban is also on Tehran, correct?
He is in Tehran.
He's
the
in
series,
Tehran.
Yeah.
Yeah. I have yet to watch it, but I've heard great things. I really want to.
It's very interesting. You should watch it and then give your opinion. Yeah. Yeah. Listen, there's issues with it. You know, it's not perfect, and it's not even always, you know, perfect in terms of being riveting television. Like, I wouldn't say it's up there with, you know, Sopranos or something that I. But it's very engaging. Like, I couldn't you know, once you start, you're in. And I think that's what I've heard pretty universally. Like it's binge worthy.
Yeah. I like its music as well.
Yeah.
It has, it's not, it has a kind of Israeli Arabic taste.
Yes.
The music. It's not
yes.
Persian, but I like it.
Yeah, I like it too. I like it too. It's the theme song. It's actually quite good. Maybe we can get Sina Batai to do a Santur version of the theme song. All right. Is it time for letters? Actually, before we get to letters, I was going to ask about this. We mentioned that last week we had, or a couple weeks ago, we did the special with regards to Nasreen Sotoudeh, and we would be remiss if we didn't mention the latest on her. And I want to make sure it's the latest that we know. So, Captain Reza, what can you tell us?
So there is apparently, I'm looking at the Guardian right now, there's been, Nasreen has been granted temporarily release so that she can go to the hospital and get treatment because her health is, she's not in good condition. It doesn't mean it doesn't mean freedom whatsoever, but it's good news to say the least.
Yeah. So that's from a couple of days ago. Is that the latest? There's no change in that.
There hasn't been any updates ever since.
Well, we encourage folks to listen to our episode on her and featuring all kinds of folks who know her and know her case very well in Iran. And of course, a message from her husband, Reza Khandan, who in fact, in that message was saying, we're hoping to get her at least a temporary release for the sake of her health. So, khoshbakhtane, that happened. We have to hope that, I mean, who knows what's happening with the Nasreen situation. It was funny because a friend of mine texted me all excited, she's been freed, and then when I looked it up on the weekend, I looked it up and saw that she's been released for the sake of health for a little bit, so I guess we'll see.
Some people say that Iran uses some of these political or human rights activists as a bargaining chip to negotiate with US over different deals and stuff like that. So who knows if being Biden being elected for president right now and they want to reopen negotiations for the nuclear deal and stuff like that, if what's going to happen.
I can hear there's at least 1,000 different opinions on what you just said, which is the perfect segue to letters.
Yay. Okay, so last week on episode 59, we had an entire show dedicated to the Iranians and the U.S. elections. We had internationally recognized author and academic Dr. Mehzad Burujerdi, as well as broadcaster and political analyst Reza Gorharzad, to have a discussion on the subject. And to say the very least, the comments alone should just go to show how divided the Iranian diaspora is on the subject. Yeah. So let me just
start. The diaspora is the word.
Diaspora.
Both.
Yeah, that word alone
Both
has a lot of...
can't even get past the word.
It's controversial. But to be correct, it is diaspora.
Okay.
All right. On YouTube, we have username Ross, last name Ver. I don't know what, there's no full name listed. So this, he or she said, the biggest change Biden can make is a more clear cut and less vague JCPOA deal. Iran and Zarif need to budge a little to make things work. I understand they wanted no part of any deal with Trump, but if they want to move forward and continue to have a relationship with the USA, they will need to update the JCPOA deal.
Yep.
So, and remember how last week I brought up some old letters from the Maz Jobrani episode, and they weren't particularly positive letters. They were basic, a lot of people were criticizing him for his political views and saying, you're a comedian and so on and so forth. Hope, we have a Matty Bish says, I believe Keon wrote the comment criticizing Maz. And let me assure you, I did not. Mm-hmm. That was just comments that came in.
Your naked anti-Maz Jobrani campaign has been found out.
To be clear, I love him as a comedian and actor, but don't necessarily agree with his political views, which is fine, because I don't agree with you, Jian, sometimes, but we're still friends. Yeah. Look at that.
You don't agree with my acting and comedy. You agree with my political views.
No, the opposite. Well, moving on to Instagram, we have Afshin Sihakali wrote, "Thanks for your rather tasty intro at the beginning of the program about lubia polo, and excellent reviews and reflections by your invited guests regarding the U.S. election. Great job and keep up the good work."
Really? That's the letter? That was a very positive
letter. It was. All right. But I'm...
letter of the day. Let's just quit while we're at it.
Oh, we're just getting started, Jian. All right. Next up, we have Sadaf Dargahi wrote, "The Lubia Polo story is so funny. I usually listen to Roqe while I'm running, and this discussion cracked me up. And Kianjian, Trump truly wasn't a good person for being president. He knew COVID was going to hit the US, but he didn't even care because he didn't know better. If your mom says, 'Kian, go inject Lysol to be safe from COVID,' you would think she was making a joke. But this clown said it in front of scientists as a suggestion. This is only one of the millions of things he said over the past 4 years, which were all nonsense." Well, Biden also doesn't
that was
make
a... That was a letter that I wrote as Sadaf Dargahi.
Yeah, one could argue that you wrote that. Listen,
there's... Very nicely said. I mean, yeah. The people who were attacked... Because you've said yourself, you don't love Trump.
I don't love him as a person. But
and you know, this is not... For me, too, it's not... The idea is everybody's rushing to put everybody in an ideological box. Mm-hmm. And is it possible to refuse that? Like, is it possible to say, I don't just reflexively like and dislike people based on being right wing or left wing. Mm-hmm. I happen to think the travel ban was a horrible thing. And I happen to think the bungling of the COVID, the pandemic, has been a terrible thing for America. He could be green, left, right, you know, blue, red, whatever stripe politically, and I would have said this is a bungling of the pandemic, and I would have said I hate the travel ban. That doesn't necessarily mean I need to be put in a box, does it?
No, I don't think so, and I hope people don't put me in a box.
Well, you're actually more right.
We vote, or if we had the option to, we vote based on ourselves and our families' situation, right. And I have several reasons why I would have voted Trump, even though I'm American. I very well could have. I chose not to because, right, I don't live there.
Oh, you could have voted.
I could have, yes. Oh. But I chose not to because, let's face it,
you could have made the difference for your buddy Trump. You could have.
Listen, Jian, it's a little rigged, wasn't it?
But
okay. All right, let's not touch that. Let's not go there. Anyway, one other reason is because I have a lot of family in the U.S. as well, and the bulk of them are in Minnesota, and that's a Democratic state. And based on what I've seen, how that Democratic state is ran, it wasn't to my liking or there. So anyway, moving on. Let's not go any further. And then we have Naz Ghan on Instagram wrote, "I like how CNN's Don Lemon dissected the single issue voters. Many people who declared they didn't like Trump's personality but voted for him because of a particular single issue, mainly the economy. Don Lemon said you cannot separate Trump's personality, his racist, misogynist rhetoric, and what he stands for from any single issue you like about his performance. When you vote for him, you are supporting the whole package of Trump. And as a human being, he fails pretty much on every level." All right, that's an opinion.
Yeah, well, the single issue that Naz Ghan is referring to, the fact that both Mehrzad Burjerdi and Reza Gohersad talked about how Iranians in a lot of cases are in some cases at least, are single issue voters. The ones who are supporting Trump are doing so because they believe he's the best answer for regime change. The ones who aren't supporting are believe it's the best answer for the return to the JCPOA, whatever. And they were both appealing to the idea that Iranian Americans, given that they're both Iranian Americans, should be looking at a broader set of criterion for who they vote for. But like Cuban Americans in Miami voting for Trump, there've been a lot of single issue voters. So that's who I guess what Naz is talking about there. And interesting position. Yeah. Don Lemon says a lot of things.
Yeah. And then taking the other end of that debate, we have Atife Tabish. She wrote, "Well, Jian, first of all, I like you. Okay. Your interviews..."
Uh-oh. It's off to a good start.
You can already tell.
I sense things are going to turn. Yeah.
All right. Your interviews and your voice are outstanding. I will keep listening because I enjoy the show a lot. But this show on the U.S. elections and the conversations disappointed me a lot. I'm not a U.S. citizen, so I don't have any opinion. But to be fair, you and most of all other medias were biased, and that's okay on a personal level, but not on a journalistic level. Journalists cannot take sides and have to report the truth. I didn't hear anything about the transparency of votes, ghost voters, and so on. All your opinions were the reflection of CNN and CBC. No new material there for eager listeners like me. And please don't call names. Calling someone a Trumpist is so unfair. I strongly believe that modern citizens are slaves of the media. I want the truth. I love Roqe. Kudos to Kian to raise her voice in this cruel time. And kudos to all of the Roqe team.
Thank you so much for that letter, Atife. Thank you for your support of Roqe, and for that was a very balanced, nice letter. I disagreed that there was no new information. I think we did a whole program on how divided the Iranian diaspora is. I'm not sure in English media who's doing that. Where was that show on CNN or CBC? I don't know. But you know, I get your point. I mean, my commitment here is to try and bring in as many different voices as possible on this program within reason. But this is not a news program, you know? I mean, this is not BBC Persian or CBC. They exist. You can go to them and you can blame them for if there's imbalance. I'm not a traditional journalist here. I'm the host of a program that is, by its nature, you know, elastic in terms of what we do here. And I will have opinions. I always have. I did for years in the other programs I did. I'll continue to. It doesn't mean I won't try to be fair. I think you know that, actually, if you've been listening to this program. But if I think the incarceration of Nasrin Sotoudeh is a travesty, I'm going to say it. If I think Ali Azimi is an awesome songwriter, I'm going to come out and say it. And if I think the Muslim ban, or the travel ban, as I called it earlier, generously, it's actually, he called it the Muslim ban, on Iranians was outrageous, I'm going to say that. I totally, totally respect the right of folks to disagree, and I'll always be interested in hearing their voices as well, including yours, Atife. So, I'm gonna have opinions sometimes, you know? Yeah.
That's unacceptable. I'm kidding. So when was it? Last week we posted a video on Instagram catching Shaya June in the act of yet again finishing all the office lubia polo. So a few people wrote about
that. The continued vacuuming of the lubia polo, wherever it is, by Shaya.
All right, so we have Bahar, last name HGH, on Facebook wrote, Jian June, how could you claim Shaya's lubia polo, which was basically meant for him only? We all know that you have the privilege of having a Tabrizi mom. Firstly, she lives here, and secondly, she cooks for you with that awesome Tabrizi daspocht. And that's documented in one of the episodes where you talked about having some Maman Paz khorosht kadu in the fridge, which obviously you never shared. I gather that Shaya's parents are not here. So for any homemade food that comes around, Shaya is the first to have whatever he wants, and then you come second. Sorry, but that's only fair.
That's actually a very logical argument. However, I think if Shaya's parents were to make him food, I wouldn't necessarily claim it. And he can't claim my mother's food. But this was Reza's girlfriend,
yes.
Who's sort of neutral territory, Switzerland on this, right? That's and right. The lubia polo should be democratically meted out amongst the citizens of Roqe.
Cool. And then we also have a Ajang Zandnia on Instagram wrote, let's mark this day as National Lubia Polo Day in calendars. And every year, cook and share our lubia polo with our fellow co-workers in memory of all the Roqe victims from this unpleasant event.
Yes.
That's a good idea.
Yes.
All right. Bob, moving on. So last week, June, outed me on the fact that I have a new love interest who just happens to be a doctor. Jian, of course, made it seem like I only date doctors and go out hunting for them, basically.
No. Let me be clear. He doesn't happen to be a doctor. The only description of him that you've ever given anyone is that he's a doctor. We knew nothing else about him.
Well, what else?
I'm seeing the doctor. The doctor is taking me out. I went to the ballet with the doctor. doctor. My knee, the doctor was there. So, I mean, you know, if you had said I was with the guy who enjoys playing football, I was with my friend who's a fan of the West Wing, we would have had some other descriptions of him.
We just
know him as a doctor.
I didn't want to say his name, basically.
Uh-huh. What does he look like? Is he bald? Is he tall?
I don't know, Jian. What does he look like?
I met him on the weekend.
You did.
I did. I met him amidst the pizza with ketchup on it.
Do you approve?
Listen, the way this man lathers the ketchup on the pizza is like a surgeon. He is like a... Wait, he is a surgeon. No, it's a... He was very nice. I liked him a lot. He was... I thought he was... Khoshtip, khoshmashraf, khoshmashrab.
Most importantly,
And he was, you know, he seemed to care about young Keon. That I liked that.
Just a great guy in general.
Yes.
Hub, on Facebook, we have a Kamal, last name MSV, wrote, "It seems Keon is proud of her doctor. Good for you, Keon. Your mom is probably proud too. مامان میگه اگر خودت دکتر نشدی تلاش کن با یه مرد دکتر ازدواج کن." Translation, he's basically saying, your mom probably says, if you can't become a doctor yourself, marry a doctor.
There you go.
Oh, look at that. It's time for letter of the day.
Yes.
The sound of three people clapping.
I know.
Me too.
And a fourth person. Riveting.
A few days ago, can I talk?
Can we get some audience? Shaya.
Yes.
Shaya Jun.
Yes.
Shaya Jun. Azizam. میتونی بری یه پیدا کنی یه ساوند افکت بگیری.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you should find like a crowd sound. So that, yeah, exactly. So that it just doesn't sound like me and Captain Reza and a couple of
happy to be put out of our misery.
Yeah, so like some of the trained seals just like.
After letters of the day, I want to explain khoshmashrab, the origin of khoshmashrab.
So I said khoshmashraf. That's not a word, right?
No, it's khoshmashrab.
Khoshmashrab.
Mashrab came from wine.
Uh-huh.
And khoshmashrab means you can have wine with that
them.
Guy
oh.
and have a...
Are you still going to explain it after the letter of the day, or is that
no,
you just
I
did
just
it? All right, thank you. All right, letter of the day.
Khob. Yeah. Yay. All right, Khob, a few days ago we posted a Roqe Minute on Instagram from episode 8 of Roqe, which featured an interview with actress and model Mandana Karimi. I love that episode, by the way. She was very Roqe about her difficult journey of becoming an actress, despite coming from an extremely religious family back home in Iran.
She's now a Bollywood star.
Yeah, she
Mumbai.
Is. So in that specific Roqe Minute we posted was part of the part where you asked her what message she has for the people back in Iran.
Mm.
And her answer was basically, I'm paraphrasing, she believed the people need to have unity and never give up because this isn't the time to give up. Khob, on Instagram, we have a, speaking of doctors, we have a Dr. Samira Talebi. Mm. She's a geneticist in Iran.
In Iran?
Yeah, in Iran. Okay. She says, Mandana Jan, I think many Iranian girls like me are different from you. We live in love with our home and in love with our dear parents. Despite the problems, we have stayed in Iran. We will remain strong and strive for the honor of our dear Iran.
Mm.
Beautifully written.
So that's Dr. Samira in Iran,
yeah,
writing to say, you know, not all of us have left and not all of us. That's great. That's mm-hmm. a great letter. I mean, it's great to hear a voice from inside Iran pushing back on what Mandana had to say. That's really interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you so much, Dr. Samira Talebi, for the letter of the day. Thanks to all of you guys out there who've been writing to us with all your different opinions. We appreciate them all, even when you're disagreeing with us. That's part of that's the name of the game, in fact. Thank you so much for all of that. Thanks, Captain Reza, Groovy Shaya, Fabulous Keon. See you guys on Thursday. This is full time for Roqe for today. Hey, hang on, we were gonna go out on some Liraz.
Oh yeah,
you got that set up? Because I want to go out on some music by Liraz from her brand new album.
Yes.
Zen. We're gonna play a song called Inja. Get that ready, Shaya. Our website is rookmedia.com. That's the hub of all things Roqe. If you want to link to all of our platforms, please subscribe if you've not done already on all of our platforms. Just subscribe everywhere so we can let you know what's happening with Roqe. We really appreciate that. Thanks to the amazing team who put this show together, producer Susan Ponta, the artist, Thoughtful Nagin, The Fabulous Keon, Savvy Roham, Alkaya Mehrdad, English Muhammad, Captain Reza, and Gubi Shaya. Thank you to all of you out there supporting us and sharing our content. Again, please subscribe if you haven't done so already. You can find me on Instagram at Jian Ghomeshi. Mizun Bashi.